Welcome to Tokyo Wave, recorded in a live studio in Harajuku, Japan, with your hosts, Aaron and Parker.
All right, everyone, welcome to episode 10 of Tokyo Wave. We're your hosts, Aaron Randall
and Parker Allen. On Tokyo Wave, we bring you weekly updates from our studio in Harajuku.
Join us in segments featuring this week's top news,
political happenings,
business,
and the occasional dank meme that melts steel beams.
All right, so starting off with This Week in Japan, here are this week's top news highlights.
This Week in Japan.
Goodbye, Japan's state of emergency. Hello, what do we do now?
After Terrace House star Hana Kimura's tragic death, Japan moves to unmask cyberbullies.
An escaped racehorse and a meth head in a Mercedes both get caught red-handed. So, first up, Japan's state of emergency is now ancient history, as Prime Minister Abe has said sayonara to the national state of emergency, as Tokyo, Chiba, Kanagawa, Saitama, and Hokkaido have now been released from the state of emergency, which occurred on May the 25th via a press conference. That being said, there are some differing messages between what we're hearing from the national government and individual prefectures.
So, as we mentioned in our last episode, Tokyo has its own coronavirus roadmap, a three-stage plan to reopen. Governor Koike has stated that Tokyo will incrementally repeal business closure requests for select facilities over the course of several weeks and months based on infection rates or whether any clusters have been reported.
Currently, libraries, museums, and other cultural hubs have been allowed to reopen, and restaurants are now asked to close before 10 p.m. instead of 8 p.m., which was the case under the state of emergency.
Those two crucial hours.
Well, if you think about it, though, I mean, closing at 10 and closing at 8, I mean, 8 is normal business times, I mean, kind of peak dinner time. So.
Right. We're talking about the difference between probably family and then, you know, drunk guys going out. And,
yes.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if the restaurant actually closes at 8, though, it has to be closed by 8. So they were stopping drinks at 7. And so, often I'll go to usually dinner at 7 or 8. And then, you know, you'll want to be drinking until at least 9 or 10.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think it's just 2 hours. But in the way that the dining out culture works in this country, I do think that's going to make a huge difference. Unfortunately, though, what's going to happen if everybody decides that they really, really want to go out to eat now that they haven't been in like 2 or 3 months?
Yeah. I think that's probably the fear on everyone's mind, is that everyone at the same time will make the same decision to go out and use the trains and everything. So
as we mentioned in every episode, our studio here in Harajuku is in the heart of Japan's biggest fashion district. And I went out to the bank just a few minutes ago and... Oh, what state of emergency? It looks like business as usual out there.
Yeah.
Kind of scary. I hope this doesn't, trigger that second wave that everybody talks so ominously about.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, in addition to the other reopenings, prefectural schools in Tokyo, Chiba, Kanagawa, Saitama, and Hokkaido prefectures have begun to welcome students back from June the 1st. And also from June the 1st, the government still advises against travel to Tokyo, Chiba, Kanagawa, Saitama, and Hokkaido. And this request is set to expire on June the 19th. So the state of emergency has been lifted, but essentially the government is saying stay put.
Mm.
And in a definite buzzkill to anyone who is temporarily locked out of Japan due to the border restrictions, on May 25th, the Japanese government also announced that they have extended the entry ban until the end of June.
Yeah, and they added a few more countries as well, is that right?
Yes, it's now 111 countries that are banned from entry to Japan.
Jeez, yeah. I've read some really scary stories about, executives that were forced to go to a board meeting in Taiwan and couldn't get back into Japan. Yeah. So,
jeez.
Yeah.
You know, to be honest with you, I really do not like the way the government has basically locked us in and locked everyone else out.
Mm.
I understand the safety concerns here, but for instance, compare that with Canada, where they have a ban on non-essential travel. And so that is on a case-by-case basis, and basically when you enter the country, you have to give the border control officer a valid reason for why your travel is essential rather than non-essential.
Right. Yeah, kind of just like the really basic like business or pleasure reasoning, right? For the visas also that are banned, I was really surprised to see the highly skilled professional and, you know, the basic work visa, which a lot of foreign nationals have here in Japan. And they're just outright banned, right?
Yes.
I think the spouse visa, you can do some negotiating
at
customs.
That is right.
But still, it's, you know, up in the air.
Yes. Well, and so that's the problem, because when things are up in the air in the Japanese context, that's usually a fancy way of saying, we're not going to let you do it.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, if it were up in the air in Canada or the United States, I mean, people would probably make a logical decision based on the facts. But leaving it up in the air to the immigration agency of Japan, I wouldn't want to screw with that.
Oh no, for sure.
So definitely it's stay put for the time being, and you know, unfortunately, I hope that in the future Japan will give a little bit more leeway to the foreign residents here, especially long-term foreign residents, but sure ain't looking like it's gonna happen this time.
Yeah. All right, and next up, pro wrestler and Terrace House star Hana Kimura dies at age 22. Nikkei Asian Review has reported that Japan's ruling Liberal Democratic Party has begun discussions on new rules to stop online abuse after the suicide death of Netflix star Hana Kimura, who had suffered from social media bullying.
In its first meeting, the LDP's Online Abuse Task Force discussed proposals for a law that would lay out a process for internet providers to disclose information that can identify users beyond anonymous social media posts. The lawmakers noted that the current process lacks effectiveness.
So Upper House member Junko Mihara, an actress turned lawmaker who heads the Anti-Cyberbullying Task Force, stated that humiliation suffered online leaves a permanent mark that weighs heavily on victims. She also stated that she favors stronger penalties for online abuse.
This task force came to be after the 22-year-old Kimura, a female professional wrestler who starred on the popular Netflix reality show Terrace House, was reported dead Saturday. A suicide note was found at her Tokyo home.
The task force will also weigh creating a hotline that victims of online abuse can turn to for help.
Already, an industry coalition of social media platforms in Japan, including Twitter, Facebook, Line, and TikTok, have released a pledge to do more to suspend the accounts of those accused of cyberbullying.
Wow, so there's a lot to unpack.
You know, and it happened very suddenly, and, you know, unfortunately, I'm sure that she is not going to be, certainly not the first or the last person to be a victim of cyberbullying. It is important and relevant for Japanese society that this has become such an issue. And also, I think we can definitely reference the reality that in, you know, maybe 5 or 10 years ago, this would have just been a Japanese domestic situation that made domestic national headlines. But Terrace House is global because of Netflix.
Right.
So the Japanese cyberbullying problem is now, you know, dirty laundry that is aired out for the world to see. Of course, cyberbullying is not just a Japanese problem, but one thing, you know, maybe some of our listeners might not be totally familiar with is that Japan has a very infamous, anonymous online culture of extreme cyberbullies.
Yes.
They say some whacked out, terrible stuff about people.
So, you know, those abroad are probably familiar with the website 4chan, who is very infamous for causing lots of hacks, causing a lot of, you know, character assassinations on Twitter and bullying. But, you know, 4chan actually originated from 2chan here in Japan. And you know, Parker, I think our generation, we definitely obviously had bullying in the classroom, but we definitely skipped or missed out on the really incredible explosion of bullying that is online. And, you know, when I first heard about online bullying here in Japan, maybe 5 years ago, working at a Japanese company, talking to coworkers and their kids are in middle school and hearing stories, I kind of thought, is it really that big of a deal? But, you know, you start to see the numbers of these suicides, see the kind of things that kids are saying to each other, you know, just telling each other to die. And where, you know, in the States, we might come up with some clever, funny, you know, very raunchy thing to say to one another. But here in Japan, it seems to always boil back to something related to death.
Yes, yes. One also, if you think about the issue with cyberbullying, I mean, back in the day, you know, when we were kids, that was kind of before text messaging. I mean, we were younger.
Yeah.
And so the ability to harass one another using the written word is sort of an advent of new media.
Absolutely.
And also being able to harass one another anonymously through kind of shared channels.
Right, right, right.
And so really these, it's almost like you're giving these kids assault rifles. And obviously some of them will take it to the extreme. And I mean, it's unfortunate. I mean, I think a lot, you know, the people who are saying unfair things to this, you know, poor actress who took her own life, I think you'll find out that a lot of them were probably middle school students, you know, kids.
Yeah, they
but
just
saying these, you know, ridiculous, horrible things that no one should say.
Right, right. It, a lot of it, you know, whether it's taking place, you know, at a local school or it's just something that's online, a lot of people will see something that's just trending, you know, hop on the bandwagon. And like you said, either do it anonymously or using their own account, harass someone. This bleeds into this new cancel culture that we see happening too, where, you know, if some comedian or if someone fairly, you know, famous, some old dirt is dug up on them from maybe 10 years ago of one thing that they said, and then all of a sudden Twitter decides that, oh, they're canceled. I don't know if you've seen this before.
Yes, yeah. Definitely. Well, and we talk about that a lot in the American context, but even in Japan, kind of this dogpiling on a celebrity. I mean, what was it? Erika Sawajiri with the allegations of using MDMA. What was that, last year?
Ah, yeah, yeah. Maybe last year, year and a half.
Yeah, I mean, she was really ran through the mud for, you know, doing recreational drugs, which is illegal in Japan. And obviously, doing illegal things is not good, but I mean, even people were saying back then that, I mean, did she really deserve getting that much of a, you know, a full court press for something that, you know, didn't really hurt anybody else?
Right, right. I think anytime someone has to ask the question, do they really deserve this? The answer is overwhelmingly no.
Yes. Well, and I mean, the situation with Hana Kimura is really unfortunate because, I mean, there are lots of implications for the online bullying and social media, and also the sensationalization and sexualization of characters on, you know, reality TV shows, and how that plays out on social media. Because, you know, people don't just watch television or, you know, these online subscription services. They're watching it while they're using social media, and they're commenting kind of in real time.
Right, right.
And so as they're watching, you know, the new episode of this drama, this, you know, reality show, they're making comments and they're, you know, making jokes, and some of them are very unfair and sometimes are something that goes beyond a certain point. And especially people are starting to talk about the fact that she was not pure Japanese, that she was biracial and was also of Indonesian heritage. And maybe some of this cyberbullying had a bit of racial or prejudice undertones that might have been even more offensive and nasty than it would have been otherwise.
Yeah, that wouldn't surprise me at all. I mean, yeah, a lot of these online communities kind of thrive off of that. You know, another interesting point is reality shows have been around for about 20 years from the States, right? And, you know, Terrace House is the most popular reality show and maybe the only kind of true original reality show format here in Japan. And on these reality programs, you know, they're videotaping people 24/7. So they can really, the editors and the producers can tell any story that they want. If they want one character to look like the bad guy, it's not difficult. You got 24 hours of footage, you know, 2 weeks, 3 weeks of them doing different things. You can very easily piece together a story so that the viewer's like, oh, wow, this person's terrible.
Yes,
and then,
yes.
Boom, Twitter explodes.
Well, I think especially in the case of Hana, she was, you know, a young, kind of spunky professional wrestler who had a very strong personality.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she was painted with that kind of bad girl or kind of villain-esque brush.
Mm-hmm.
And so, obviously, the producers probably thought they were just making great entertainment, but now she's dead. She's not going to come back.
Jeez, yeah, man. Yeah, yeah. We got to remember that these are lives that we're messing with. Yeah, maybe it's the end of reality television.
Good riddance. Next up, on a weirder note, an escaped racehorse and a meth head in a Mercedes both got caught red-handed.
Whoa, buddy. NHK reported that a retired racehorse escaped from its stable in Shinagawa Ward and struck a car at a nearby intersection.
According to police, the male retired racehorse with the super ironic name Saint Memory rammed the side of a white van at the Yashiobashi intersection in the Oi area at around 11 a.m. on May the 25th.
The horse was returned to the Oi racecourse alive but with injuries and apparently lost a large amount of blood from its tangle with the white van.
NHK TV footage showed a broken window and a large dent in the side of the van.
The racehorse made it 1.5 kilometers away from the stable. In some of the security camera footage that was broadcast, Saint Memory can be seen running down a lane of traffic as vehicles pass in the opposite direction.
Over his 8-year career, Saint Memory won 17 races before retiring in 2016. He now serves as a guide horse at the Oi Racecourse. And the source of his undying hatred for white vans was not revealed.
The other jailbird this week is unfortunately not a mischievous horse, and considerably more meth was involved.
FNN reported that a 31-year-old woman has been arrested after leading Tokyo's finest on a high-speed chase, which tragically ended with her killing a female pedestrian with her Mercedes.
According to police, Marisa Nakagawa, an employee of a hostess bar, sped off in her white AMG Mercedes SL63 down Daini Keihin Highway after being questioned by police for behaving suspiciously.
Makes me think a bicycle was involved. So this patrol car lost track of Nakagawa soon after the high-speed chase began, which is unsurprising as an AMG SL63 has 577 horsepower, or 576 more than Saint Memory.
However, Nakagawa's impaired state did not help her with driving. About 850 meters from where the hot pursuit began, Nakagawa lost control and drove up onto a sidewalk where she fatally struck 34-year-old company employee Yu Takahashi.
In what sounds like a scene that should be in the Japanese reboot of Breaking Bad, Nakagawa fled her busted-up Benz and went inside a nearby 10-story apartment building where officers apprehended her.
Police have charged Nakagawa with involuntary manslaughter and hit-and-run, and illegal drug use.
Nakagawa was quoted by police after the accident. "I took too many drugs, but since I do not remember anything up to the collision, I do not know if that was the reason for the crash." Well, she will have a lot of time to think about that in the slammer.
Welcome to death row.
You're gonna get Jeez, another lot to unpack here. So
Aaron, what do you think this racehorse and the meth head have in common?
They both like, I don't know. I can't think of anything good right now. Do you have?
No, I was hoping you had something. I saw these two stories, and I'm like, I don't know why, but I just want to put them together.
Yeah.
They're like gin and tonic. They're totally different, but they go well together.
Yeah, we've all been cooped up for the past 2 or 3 months. You know, I think the horse and this Nakagawa both just wanted to get out so bad. And Nakagawa definitely took the wrong road by doing a lot of meth before driving. So one of the big surprises for me here is that meth is alive and well in Japan. That's pretty wild.
I just love the quote. I took too many drugs, but since I do not remember anything up till the collision, I do not know if that was the reason for the crash. I mean,
I really hope that's her lawyer's deposition.
Johnny Cochran needs to hurry up and one, rise from the dead, and two, learn Japanese.
Isn't it wild that all of OJ's attorneys died except for, what was his name? Did you know about this? They all died very strange deaths. Shapiro.
Ah.
Shapiro's the only one that could, I think it was the stress of the trial. Shapiro was the only one that could handle it because he was used to it. He had done this so many times. Yeah. But the other guys, man, that weighed on him a lot. Anyways, random tidbit.
Or is it that Chappelle skit where like he keeps on meeting OJ and like one day like after a comedy show like he comes into the green room and he's just the nicest guy, he's real chubby, he's like, all right guys, I've got to go, and he leaves the room, and as soon as he leaves the room, like everybody including Dave Chappelle like look at each other like, he did that shit.
The next time I met OJ, I think
that's how it goes.
One of his current bits.
And I walked into the green room, and OJ was already in there. I was like, how the fuck is this possible? I was scared.
He said, no, thank you for your hospitality. Good night, guys. And we said, good night. And he just walked out of the room. And as soon as the door closed, we all looked at each other like, that nigga did that shit. I could feel like murder in the room.
God, I hope this, I mean, honestly, you know, hurry up and get this global pandemic over so that Dave Chappelle will come back to Japan and make us laugh again.
I know,
that show was so good.
That was epic. That was really good. All right, so this week on The Weird Thing of the Week, we're going to demystify Japan's famously weird real estate rental market.
You're now listening to Tokyo Wave. The Weird Thing of the Week.
Oh, hell no! Okay.
So, Aaron, you used to work at a rental agency.
I did. For about 3 years, I worked at a super domestic Japanese real estate company. I mainly dealt with leasing contracts and specifically foreign clientele.
And also, one of my longtime clients is a real estate company, and the industry has always been a subject of fascination for me. So, today, in The Weird Thing of the Week, this is actually going to be somewhat of an advice column. So, as anybody who's ever lived in Tokyo knows, the sheer number of real estate listings in this metropolis is massive.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, the industry is extremely complicated and confusing, and I would say among foreigners in Japan is mainly looked at as this behemoth monolith of, we don't want to rent to you, Gaijin.
Yeah, so, you know, the entranceway into, obviously, getting a property, whether you're going to buy or rent, you have to use local agents. The agents all run on fax machines, and all of the properties that the agents manage are owned mostly by much older Japanese that have a much more older way of thinking, you know, back even before Showa era. A lot of the practices and things that they are used to are things that are just completely gone globally in business these days.
Exactly. And of course, infamously, there's a lot of discrimination against foreigners. Mm. And When I'm talking about discrimination, it's not implicit discrimination, it's explicit discrimination. Literally, on the piece of paper that says the listing, it will say in big bold letters, no foreign nationals.
Yes. Yeah, you know, where I worked too, there were properties that were okay for foreigners, and there were properties that weren't okay. And the only reason the ones that were okay were okay is because that we negotiated with the owners to allow foreigners to come in.
And that really ends up being a terrible situation in which the nicer properties that, you know, they're competitive and at the right price and they're nice and well-appointed end up being no foreigners. And the properties that are either inadequate to the regular standards and therefore inferior to most apartments, or they're nice apartments but they're super expensive, these end up being the apartments that foreigners get shown. And of course, that's just part of the tamale. You know, what is up with this whole key money thing? I mean, I know we've both gone down the block on this a billion times, but key money, or Daikin, is this gift money. It's a non-refundable fee that dates back to the Meiji era, or around the time of the Kanto Great Earthquake, when much of Tokyo was destroyed by this earthquake and subsequent fires, and so landlords were in a position of choosing who they rented property to, and this choice process was mainly based on who gave them the best bribe.
Yes.
So basically, Daikin is an institutionalized bribe to the owner to pretty please with sugar on top, let me rent your property.
And yeah, unfortunately, the same economic conditions don't exist today, obviously. But this system for key money, or Daikin, is still heavily used. You know, it's interesting. A lot of people complain about the real estate market here in Japan, being a foreigner trying to rent a property. But, you know, really, any expat in any other country is going to face a lot of difficulties. In South Korea, you have to pay 1 year's worth of rent in order to start the leasing agreement.
Wow. Well, also, I mean, the thing about key money, I mean, obviously, you know, Daikin, you know, it's a bribe, it's free money for the owner, and people criticize it a lot, but that also, I mean, we're in a very competitive real estate market with basically no rent control. So,
but
there are a lot of properties on the market. So everybody has to be price competitive. And so if you compare the rent prices in Tokyo compared to any major global city in the developed world, I mean, look at San Francisco or New York City. I mean, the rent prices are what? 3 to 5 times as much.
And
they have rent control. So it's, I mean, obviously, there are some silly systems and there are some prejudices, but if you look at the overall money for value, Tokyo's real estate market does not leave you that much to complain about.
Absolutely. You know, my friends in New York and San Francisco, Hong Kong, whenever I tell them how much I pay monthly, they're always shocked because, you know, they're paying 3 to 4 times for about the same amount of space. And a lot of people are like, oh, Japanese apartments are very small. You know, actually, if you live, you know, a little bit out of the center of the city, you can get quite a nice size apartment for a really good deal, although it is tacked on with this key money and everything. But, you know, hey, you can't have it all, right?
Right. Well, also, I mean, in having lived in Japan for 13 years now and dealt with many real estate situations of my own, and also helped a lot of friends find places to live, rental properties, I have come to the conclusion that Japan's real estate market has a lot of strange peculiarities, but if you look at it from a strategic perspective, and even as a foreign national, and even if your Japanese isn't that great, if you can go at it with the right attitude and you are persistent and you know what you want and you can go through the motions and, you know, keep your eyes on the prize, you can have a good result.
No, for sure. Yeah, you know, the biggest advice I have for anyone coming here, whether you're abroad and looking at properties, or if you're already in Tokyo or Japan and talking to people, give yourself time. you know, give yourself, if possible, 3 to 6 months, because the first agent you talk to is not necessarily going to be the agent. You're going to need to talk to a lot of different agents. You're going to need to put on your BS radar, because a lot of these guys will have no idea what they're talking about. I mean, if you want to get super Japanese on this thing, you need to ask these agents, how long have you been doing this? Show me proof. You know, guys who have been doing it for 5 to 10 years, they might BS you, but they're not going to try to pull your leg and slap on extra, you know, erroneous fees just because they can. They're more in it for the long term. So yeah, finding an agent you can trust is really difficult here, but you know, you got to give yourself time and try to meet with maybe, yeah, if possible, 5 to 10. Well, 10's quite a lot. 5 different agents. Yeah.
Well, and I think something about the, especially in the Tokyo market, that people just have to keep into account is because there are so many properties and there are so many real estate agents, it really is, it's a very competitive market and it's a dog-eat-dog world. And also, everybody has a very short attention span because, you know, the standard agent fee is around 1 month of the monthly rent of the apartment. So if you're looking for an apartment for 80,000 yen, the agent who's talking to you isn't going to see a dime until you are okayed into an apartment. And so the problem that a lot of foreigners run into is they'll go to an inexperienced agent who has been taught that foreigners have a tough time getting apartments. And so he sees, or she sees, the foreign customer as a bad risk. Because, I mean, they might show you 10 places and the owners might say no 10 times.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, there's literally like almost like maybe 100 check boxes that you have to check each one. And if you don't check one of them, you're going to get rejected. So an experienced agent will know right off the bat, and they'll be honest with you too. When I've gone apartment searching, I've told them what I'm looking for, and some of them are like, we don't have that, sorry, call somebody else. And I appreciate that, thank you. Let's not waste each other's time, right? I will say another thing that, you know, non-Japanese speaking foreigners have to watch out for is there are a lot of really interesting schemes that the real estate companies come up with, in which the foreign renter is paying a lot more than, say, their Japanese counterpart. Now, you know, there's kind of two points of views on this. One is that, hey, you know, what this company is doing is it's taking care of all the red tape to make sure that you can live in the apartment and you don't have to think about anything. Yes, you're paying a little bit more than your Japanese counterpart, but everything's smooth. You can don't have to worry about anything. But then the other one is, hey, like, why am I getting ripped off just for being a foreigner, right? So.
Exactly. And I mean, another thing, and I think this is different in every country around the world, but the way that you start a rental contract in Japan is you have to pay a lot of money up front. And so the standard rental contract is 2 years. And if any inkling that the prospective tenant is not going to stay for 2 years becomes known to the landlord, then they're not going to want to rent to that person because, I mean, obviously every time someone moves out and you change tenants, there's cleaning and there's, you know, replacing wallpaper and, I mean, any kind of repairs that need to be done. And so landlords want as few tenants as possible, especially in larger apartments. So shorter term contracts are really frowned upon.
Oh yeah. And, you know, most foreign nationals, when they come here, a lot of times their, you know, work contract is on a yearly basis, right? I mean, I've very, very seldom, even in my time, I think maybe once or twice, I saw like a 2 or 3 year contract, right? So that was always a negotiation point, being the agent and talking to the owner, trying to get them to understand that, no, this person, you know, will be here for 2 years. They have a good track record, etc. And also, you know, the industry here is kind of operating on low profit margins already. That's why they need this 2 years, right?
And so in central Tokyo, the profit margin for owners is usually said to be around 3 to 3.5%.
Right. So I guess, you know, if you're comparing your investment to the stock market, for example, you're always trying to be with the market or beating it. So, you know, that's right on the cusp, right?
Yeah.
So you want to make sure that all your contracts are 2 years. You know, there's no issue with any of that. So it makes sense that they're quite strict with
the whole tier. Exactly. And so it's, I mean, as far as the discrimination and the prejudice side of it goes, I mean, hopefully that's going to go away yesterday. But obviously, as far as the key money and the other peculiarities of the real estate market, you know, these old habits die hard. And if they do disappear, they will be replaced with something else, because there has to be some revenue profit generation model for the real estate industry, or it just won't make sense.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So we hope you enjoyed this kind of introduction to the real estate market in Japan and being a foreigner in Japan, renting a property. This is definitely a very big subject, so we hope to, you know, pick this up in future podcasts. Next time, we'll go into the dark side, what to do when you have problems with your landlord.
Dun, dun, dun!
All right, next up on Let's Talk About Creative Stuff Time, we're going to be talking about the resurgence of retro themes.
You're now listening to Tokyo Wave. Let's talk about creative stuff time.
It ain't no joke, as Rakim said.
All right, so we talked in the podcast before about the emergence of vaporwave and its connection to 1980s and 1990s Japanese city pop music. But taking a step back and looking at the big picture, what about this resurgence of retro music and retro culture in everything?
You know, from our favorite TV shows on Netflix to popular music, retro, and specifically 80s retro, seem to have permeated all mediums of popular culture these days.
The most obvious example being Stranger Things, which attracted record viewership on Netflix and has a broad, active, and international fan base. The series has received critical acclaim for its characterization, pacing, atmosphere, acting, soundtrack, directing, writing, and homages to 1980s films. Although it played off the 80s nostalgia for wide viewership, the show stands on its own with excellent writing, character development, and original themes.
And you know, Stranger Things, I've actually never watched it with the sound on. There's a bar that I like to go to where it plays as kind of just video. And so I'm just like watching it with no sound. And it is a wacky show if you can't hear what they're saying.
Yeah, man, my jaw just dropped when I heard you watch it with no sound. Oh my God. Yeah, you're missing out so much.
It was like an acid trip. I'm like, what in the hell are these kids doing?
Oh man. Just the intro to the show is like a synth pop thought piece, you know.
Wow.
It's so good, man.
One of these days I'll have to watch it somewhere outside of that bar.
Yeah, no, for sure. Yeah, so 80s and 90s retro can be heard all over popular music as well. And if this doesn't sound new to you, it should, as artists have been pulling from the 80s for inspiration from the 80s. But now more than ever, artists on the Billboard Top 10 are creating entire concept albums based around 80s nostalgia. Some examples include Dua Lipa, Doja Cat, amongst others. Dua Lipa, an English singer and songwriter, released Future Nostalgia in March this year, debuting at number 2 on the UK albums chart with 34,000 units. In its second week, it reached the summit of the chart, making Future Nostalgia Lipa's first UK number 1 album.
So this new album enlisted a group of veteran producers to create a nostalgic pop and disco record with influences from dance pop and electronic music, inspired by artists such as Madonna, Gwen Stefani, Moloko, Blondie, and Outkast. So that's why we like it so much.
So, Parker, you and I were both really into and are still into French House, right?
Well, you know, I'd sell my kidney if I could go see Daft Punk again.
You know, French House is an interesting use case for what we're talking about. French House, for the most part, has maintained a good niche of followers, but never went fully mainstream, excluding Daft Punk's discovery. So French House is definitely a product of 80s synth innovation and pulls heavily from the genre. If we're talking about these 80s retro thematic elements really coming to the head of pop culture, I think today, at this time, now more than ever, it is relevant, and 80s synth pop, 90s dancehall, and retro culture have successfully permeated the top of the charts, and the world loves it, or so the numbers show.
So, Aaron, you introduced me recently to Dua Lipa, and by happenstance, I came across Doja Cat, and she is also at the forefront of this super huge resurgence of retro vibes.
Mm-hmm.
And in her Say So music video, which just came out a few weeks ago, I think, it has this super disco 70s vintage vibe. And I was watching the music video, and I was just, you know, really getting into it, and I kept on watching it and watching, and then I realized, oh shit, I've seen this house before. And so the whole music video is filmed in this super modern kind of retro style house, and there's this like hunky guy who's like looking through records and like trying to fix a stereo or something like that. And I mean, the music video, I mean, there's no real plot to it. It's just kind of, it's pretty. It's like visually, it's kind of like a concept video of sorts, but it's all very, it's got kind of like that 1971 Instagram filter going on. And I just kept on watching and I realized I have seen this house before. And then I realized it all of a sudden, this is the house of the porn director in The Big Lebowski.
Oh, no shit.
That house. Wow. Jackie Treehorn.
Wow.
Jackie Treehorn writes something on a piece of paper. He's like, I need to go take a call. And then he does the thing with the pencil, and it's a big picture of a dick. You remember that part?
I'm Jackie Treehorn.
Quite a pad you got here, man. Completely unspoiled.
What's your drink, dude?
White Russian, thanks.
White Russian.
You know, I think the only thing I can say is that, you know, Doja Cat, Dua Lipa, a lot of these new artists, they're with it, quote unquote, right? Like, it's almost like watching a Tarantino movie where all of the elements that you're seeing or hearing are so well thought out, and they're referencing other material, other really good legendary material, right? Like,
yes,
the example you just gave, The Big Lebowski.
No, and it's crazy. And I mean, It also kind of blows your mind, because I mean, Doja Cat, what is she like, 23?
Also young, yeah. Dua Lipa also 22, 23.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. And I don't know, it's awesome, but it also makes me feel old.
for sure.
But I going to this retro culture and this resurgence, one person who has been riding this wave major in recent years is this random mysterious old dude.
Mm-hmm.
And he has a name, and he happens to be the owner of this infamous house, which is called the Sheets Goldstein residence. The owner, James Goldstein, is LA's superstar octogenarian bon vivant and Lakers fixture who throws parties with models and Leonardo DiCaprio as he rushes to finish his architectural legacy.
That's awesome.
In a recent Hollywood Reporter article, he's quoted as saying, "The villains always live in the modern houses." So I guess he's a villain. And I mean, the article goes on that he's actually recently built as adjacent to this historical house, which is starring in all of these music videos and movies, a nightclub that has a capacity of 1,000 people.
Wow.
And so recently, last Halloween, this nightclub housed over 1,000 revelers until 4 a.m. at this 80-year-old old dude's house.
Sounds like the Playboy Mansion.
Yeah, no, it really is. But this guy sounds marginally less creepy. I know about this person because I was thinking about the Big Lebowski house, and I was like, that has to be some famous house because it's, you know, amazing architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked it up and looked up this guy, and then I found out that he's also known as this dude who you see on the front row of all of these NBA games.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you've ever watched an NBA game and you see, you know, the front row, you see Drake and, you know, like all the big stars. There's this random old white dude in like a cowboy hat and he's like totally into it, and that's this guy.
Wow, wow.
To wrap this random tangent up, this Goldstein guy who graduated with an MBA from UCLA, the source of his riches for throwing all of these crazy parties and owning this massive house and nightclub in the middle of Beverly Hills is that he is, in fact, a California mobile home park kingpin who made his fortune packaging groups of properties into investment vehicles and then suing municipalities like Palm Springs and Palm Desert if they thwart his attempts to end rent control.
Wow.
Were we just talking about this? Yeah. It's all connected. But obviously the cities don't want to end rent control, but most cities settle and end up bringing big cash windfalls for Mr. Goldstein to fund his front row tickets to Lakers games and crazy parties with Hollywood celebrities.
No, that's interesting and wild, and it makes me jealous. I wish I was in LA going to these wild and crazy Halloween parties. But, you know, kind of going back to the whole retro thing that we were talking about, the way I see it is the 90s ended with boy band culture. And also, in the late 90s and the early 2000s, we had the entrance of social media, starting with MySpace and then evolving into Facebook. And then a lot of other online platforms became very social in themselves. So I think that we can say, when we look at media from the past up until the year 2000, this is 70s, this is 80s, this is 90s. After that, it's not really definitive. It's hard to pinpoint, you know, what is this exactly? It's kind of become a mesh of everything after the 2000s. And really, I think society as a whole is in a bit of a lost state as to how do we define what's going on right now. A lot happened, too, with the music industry and with other industries in general, with Napster, which kind of destroyed the music industry, where they were able to really procure, nurture, and almost factory create these artists with that had almost like godlike or hero-like personas, right?
You know, this reminds me of Phil Spector and the Wall of Sound.
Ooh.
Because that also was another disruption, because he created this mono sound, this wall of sound that was totally destroyed by FM radio.
Then
on top of that, the digital music revolution was another disruption. And now I think we're right in the middle of another disruption to the business, this shift from the sale of physical albums to streaming.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. So, yeah. So bringing it all back together with Western driven entertainment, if we're just talking about, you know, UK, Australia, US, Canada, etc., the record companies and producers lost their ability to cultivate and polish these artists and make them ready for a huge international market. Western music and a lot of Western entertainment has kind of been in this weird, kind of lost, undefinable state for the past 20 years. But finally, with streaming, they have a medium that they can release things on, and it's actually a release. You know, it feels like it did maybe in the 90s when a CD would come out, the way artists release music videos on YouTube, along with everything else on all the streaming platforms. And the numbers look good, too. The numbers are getting better. They're getting back up there. Obviously, the music has changed. The industry has changed. But the influences, we're still going back. It's almost like we're picking up where we left off, you know, and where are we picking it up from? We're going back to the 90s and the 80s. What's really funny to me, you know, I do listen to a lot of Korean music. I feel like in Korea, they saw this happening with in the West. And from the early 2000s, Koreans really seized the opportunity and were like, well, we're going to make our own homegrown, you know, pop music and indie music. And consequently, Korean entertainment has become a global force to be reckoned with.
And, you know, you can contrast that with Japan, obviously, because, you know, through the 80s and the 90s, as the Japanese economic powerhouse created this massive and storied, you know, musical industry, and even still, I mean, a lot of major labels are owned by Japanese conglomerates, but with J-pop and even the kind of cool Japan subsequent waves, you haven't really seen any Japanese artists really go big in a meaningful global way. I mean, I think, you know, Hikaru Utada and, you know, to a certain degree, maybe Ayumi Hamasaki might have gotten a little bit of good coverage, but that was 20 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. Right now, and these are only artists that are known within certain circles. I mean, you have to, like, be into Japan and Japanese culture, but Perfume and Sakanakshan are the only groups that I can think of that have a global audience right now from Japan.
Yes, but still, I mean, it's not topping global sales charts.
No, they're not
stuff. Exactly.
They're not on any of the Billboard charts or anything. So.
And, well, I mean, there's also the cultural imperialism angle to this as well. So I do think that the digitization of the global music market has made things a lot more equal. Whereas, you know, 30, 40 years ago, if you weren't in L.A., you were screwed. I mean, even like Black Sabbath, I mean, you know, they weren't rocking it out and making their album in the UK. I mean, they were in California.
Oh, no, for sure. Yeah. For sure. Yeah, yeah. That was a great time. You know, the big wave of rock bands from the UK, they had to. It was their goal to make it to Los Angeles. Yeah.
Apparently, that's where all the good drugs were, too. I don't know if that had anything to do with it. You know, 2020 is looking to be a very divisive year for the music business, the global music business, really, because, you know, just as we are talking about, as things are digital and obviously less people worldwide are buying CDs or even subscribing to subscription services, a lot of artists depend on revenue from live performances.
Right. It's all about the live events.
And last time I checked, you can't really do those right now.
Yeah. You know, even with the outbreak of Dua Lipa, I was like, man, when is she going to have a live concert? But then I'm like, oh yeah, we're in a pandemic, so that's not going to happen anytime
soon. Not now. And so it's really, I mean, there's no answer to this, but really, what's going to happen to music culture of this generation with it being almost impossible to feasibly have a live show for at least the next few months, if not longer?
I have seen some really good YouTube live concerts, done at artists' homes from some artists that I follow in the States, but that's really a temporary solution, right? There's nothing like seeing the artists you love live. I don't think current digital technology can replace that feeling.
Well, I think that it's a time for innovation, and also it might be a time for artists to stop and reflect and think about new directions to take their music in as they are less preoccupied by the constant hustle of the music business.
That being said,
especially people who are trying to make their big break and trying to get out there and trying to stay alive as a musician, I think that people in these situations are going to be really affected by the ongoing economic turmoil. And, you know, I'm kind of worried if maybe 2020 might be the year that kills a lot of great independent musicians.
Yeah. I have seen a lot of the more independent, musicians that live off of touring turn to teaching. So they're, you know, teaching their craft and whatever online, which is really cool. But yeah, still, I think that's a temporary solution. So we'll just have to see how things pan out.
Yes, well, we'll be watching this very closely. And if Daft Punk ever does come back, then see you next year.
Hey, listeners, that's right. You listener right there.
We want your feedback, comments, and ideas. Drop us a line at wave@tokyowave.jp. We will listen to your ideas, and we might even try something new.
We hope you enjoyed Tokyo Wave.
If you haven't already, you can subscribe to our podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, and YouTube.
Join us again next week on Tokyo Wave.